A little while back, I did a video on the remnants of the Northern Line, those little relics left over from its original construction. And now I'm going to do the same on the Central Line. Now, the Central Line has a long and complicated history, I mean, don't they all? But the Central Line is a pretty big topic, physically speaking. It's the longest line, with 46 miles of track and 49 stations. It wasn't built all at once, bits were added on, taken over from other companies, and closed down over the years. So for now, I'm just going to deal with the original section, the Central London Railway. Let's start at the very beginning, which I am reliably informed by Julie Andrews is a very good place to start. The Central London Railway was the third of the deep tubes to be built after the City and South London Railway, now part of the Northern Line, and the Waterloo and City Railway, now the entirety of the Waterloo and City Line. The Central London Railway was proposed in 1889, before the first deep tubes had even been opened. The plan was to run a line from Queensway, or Queen's Road as it was known back then, to Bank, where it would meet the Waterloo and City, City and South London, Metropolitan and District Railways. Even back then, Bank Station was a mess. The line had plenty of opposition. It would damage the sewers, they said. It would damage St. Paul's, they said. It would damage the District Railway's income, the District Railway said. Approval of the plan was held off until after the City and South London had opened in 1890. The City and South London was to be a guinea pig to see if this whole deep tube malarkey was a good idea or not. In the meantime, the Central London Railway amended their plans to extend east to Liverpool Street and west to Shepherd's Bush, where it would connect with the up-and-coming tram network. Approval finally came in 1892. Construction began in 1896 using the famous tunnelling shields designed by James Henry Greathead, who would pass away that same year. As you can imagine, based upon the objections mentioned above, construction was complicated. The line had to follow the winding streets above, which is why the line has so many tortuous curves. The first section, from Shepherd's Bush to Liverpool Street, opened in 1900. The stations were much as they are today, with two exceptions. There was no Holborn station, and instead there was a British Museum station about 100 yards from where Holborn is. And St. Paul's was known as Post Office, because there was a different station already called St. Paul's, which is now Blackfriars. I've made a separate video on that whole mess, which I will link in the description below. The line was funded by a syndicate of wealthy folk, including Natty Rothschild and Darius Ogden Mills, a pair of American investors. As a result, there was a strong American influence on the line. And that's the first intangible relic of the Central London Railway. To this day, the Underground has cars instead of the British terms carriages or coaches. Trains run northbound, eastbound, westbound or southbound, rather than up or down the line. Naturally, the line was electrified from the start. Electricity was supplied from a power station at Wood Lane, now the Exhibition London venue. The Central London was proud of their power station, so much so that they actually produced postcards of it. The line used rather hefty locomotives, nicknamed Camelbacks because of their central cab. Unfortunately, these engines were noisy and tended to vibrate, to the extent that draftsmen working in offices above the line complained that they couldn't draw straight lines when a train passed beneath. The engines would be rebuilt with better suspension, but eventually the situation was rectified in 1903, when the trains were replaced with multiple units that didn't concentrate all the power in one spot. The Central London did have some steam locomotives for maintenance work, which isn't super relevant to the rest of the story, but I just like steam trains, so here's a picture of one of them. The coaches were fairly spacious and well upholstered compared to those on the City and South London. They also included straps for standing passengers, another innovation from America. The Central London Railway were masters of publicity. The line was nicknamed the Twopenny Tube due to its flat fare of tuppence for the entire route. The Daily Mail came up with the name, but the Central enthusiastically adopted it. The Railway Gazette thought it was vulgar, but the Railway Gazette thought everything was vulgar. Ironically, the city in South London already charged a twopenny fare, but they never thought to advertise it. And as a wise man once said, you snooze, you lose. The Central had a kind of two-pronged approach to publicity. On the one hand, they targeted the cheap end of the market with their fare policy. On the other, they presented themselves as the modern, luxurious way of crossing the city. They served the financial institutions of the city and the department stores of the West End, and accordingly charged a premium for advertising space at their stations, which were, of course, lit with electricity. They were decorated with brilliant white tiles, which emphasised the cleanliness of electric traction, reflected the lighting, and gave the illusion of space. For the full effect, you need to go to Chancery Lane, where the tiling stretches right the way around. Many stations had this tiling removed over the years, but happily, many of them have also had it replaced. The tunnels, too, were painted white, which would seem to be over-egging the pudding, but what do I know? That didn't stop the railway from selling postcards of their special tunnel whitening machine. The stations were quite distinctive. Most of the original stations have been rebuilt, but at Queensway and Oxford Circus, the surface level buildings are still in place. My favourite example is this third one here at Holland Park. The stations were designed by Harry Bell Measures, and as with the white tiled platforms, they were designed to feel spacious. They were single-story structures with flat roofs upon which the word tube was emblazoned. The hope was that offices could be built on top of the stations for a bit of extra income. No one seems to have taken them up on the offer at Holland Park, although it has apparently provided a useful landing site for aliens. The Central London Railway was what we might call aggressively expansionist and would have a number of extensions over the years before finally being gobbled up by Underground Electric Railways Limited in 1913 and ultimately the London Underground 20 years later. These days, the entirety of the original railway is still in use and is an essential part of the underground network. But the innovations it introduced make it so much more than just another line. Hi all, I hope you enjoyed this flat fare episode of Tales from the Tube. If you did, please do hit the like button, share, and if you haven't already, look into the concept of subscribing for more on the Tube. There's a lot to say about the Central Line, and I really have only scratched the surface, so hopefully I'll see you again very soon for more Tales from the Tube. Cheerio.